Last question in this slide is, insects with ametabolous life cycle have this many pairs of wings? Zero.
Oh, that was an issue.
Yes. In earthworms, the segment that carries the mouth is called the prostomium.
Oh.
I got very few questions for before the exam, and if you notice, one of the questions was this one, I believe, where I mentioned the prostomium. I usually do the midterm before I actually send those emails back. So if some of the questions actually ask questions that are going to show up in the midterm, I don't change them. So it's an advantage for you to actually ask questions because you can get the answer the night before the midterm or the final exam. And then you get that fresh in your mind. This is the first multiple choice from the book, even when we actually look into all of this in lecture. Okay? This is not really from the book. One of these is not true. Which one is the false? Which one is the bad one? It's only one. Only one. Say again. C? Any other answer? The right answer, and I emphasize this here, I say it twice because I remember, and I even say, I may ask about this in the midterm and make sure that you get it right. The answer is C. Yes. Unique to mollusks is a calcium carbonate shell. Calcium carbonate shells or calcium carbonate carapaces are all over the place. What is unique is that they have three layers, three different layers. That is what is unique. Okay. Which of the following has a higher surface to volume ratio?
Oh, the first one.
Which one is bigger?
Oh, no, the second one.
The simple soil, so that has a lower surface to volume ratio.
It's bigger.
Okay. Which one has the bellow?
Hydrodon.
Which one?
Hydrodon.
The simple soil or the higher soil?
Hydrodon.
Check your nose. I think you are up and up on that one. Which of the following animals is diploblastic? That should be fairly easy. Should be
hydra.
The Nidarian. The hydra. Right? All the others have mesoderms, so they are triploblastic. Keep saying diploblastic, triploblastic, triploblastic. So it should have been an easy question. I hope it was an easy question. Okay. In one or two lines, describe the syncytial tegument. This is that layer. This is that layer. You need to pay attention. This is that layers of cells that got their membranes interrupted so the nucleus can actually move, or something in those lines. If you talk about parasitism or the function of this in relation to parasitism, you also are going to get marks. Okay? Wings of honeybees emerge from or are associated to what body region?
Thorax.
The thorax? And which part of the thorax? Mesothorax. Okay? Name one. I will see what the majority of people respond. It should be specific to the region of the thorax, not just the thorax. But if 90% of the people just say thorax, then we will go with that. Okay, but let me see what you have. Name one feature that makes a leg of a centipede different from the leg of a polypede. Yeah, one of them is jointed, the other one is unjointed. That could be, there may be a couple of other potential answers, but that is the most common one, okay? Okay. Using testicles only, name the two characteristics that make or let you recognize exactinelida. Exa means six. Six rays, and then the origin or the nature of the thing, which is silicous material or silice or silicates or any word that you want to use around silice. It's just not calcium carbonate, it's pigments. That's it.
I didn't know what I was talking
about. Okay, which of the following is not true? A, B, C, or D? C?
Yeah.
A. Earthworms can be deposit or suspension feeders. Any other answer? Are you sure?
Yes.
Oh, they're sure.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah. Earthworms are only deposit feeders. There is absolutely no suspension feeding in earthworms that happens in orchids. Okay, I think this is the last slide. In one of your other trips, you discover a new butterfly, and I ask you for a proper name, whatever name you want to come out with, as long as it's first name and last name. The first name just goes with the capital at the beginning, the second name doesn't take the capital, and both of them are underlined. So it's a proper scientific name, as I ask you to write your own name that day in the lecture. And then what is it that you need to recognize this officially as a species? A name? A specimen in a museum, and then a description somewhere in a formal journal or something. Okay. Next question is define metamerism and four metameric organisms, and that should be easy because we also talk about this here, and it's in one of the slides. Segmented worms are metameric worms. So anything about segmentation is the answer. Which of the following is not true? A, B, C, D, B, B. You say that rhodula is not present in squids. It is present in squids and puppets.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. That's the right one. That should be an easy one. That should be an easy one. Okay, which of the following is not true again? A, B, C, or D? And that again should have been easy for you. B? Any other answer?
Exoskeleton.
No other answer? Absolutely everyone wrote B.
I don't know.
Yeah, that's the one. Blue crabs have a large endoskeleton. We keep saying exoskeleton, because it's an exoskeleton, and that's why they have a very reduced skeleton. Okay? I think that's the one. Oh, there's one more slide, and then we're done.
Oh, okay.
What is the difference between coelom and pseudocoelom? One of them has incomplete mesoderm covering inside or lining inside the around the endoderm. Annelids and their trail-related phyla have this larvae in common. That should be the proper four. Yes, again. Then one of the characteristics of parasitic leeches versus parasitic flukes. These ones are annelids. These ones are flatworms. Any difference that make the difference between the two, you're good. Okay. The larva of pinophores is called centipede, or something that looks similar to centipede, because I'm sure you're going to misspell a couple of letters. And now, plus is a result of what? Sexual or asexual? Sexual. It's a larva, so. Every larvae, every egg is a result of sexual reproduction. Anterior limbs or arms of penguins and chickens are examples of homologies or analogies.
Homologies, yeah, that's the word.
Homologies?
Yeah.
How many people say analogies?
Oh, no.
No one. Everyone saying homologies. And nobody saying yes or no, so this is fun. It's homologies. So everyone went the marks there, I guess. And this, I think, is the last question. The spider has this many pagmata. Chelicerates have two. Cephalochords and abdomen. That's it. Every single one of them. So this would be two and two. And this number of walking legs, this should be eight and eight. Or four pairs of four pairs. Remember, when we talk about insects versus spiders, four pairs of legs versus two. Okay. Now that you know, how was the midterm? Yeah, I see more things. Anyways, this is just me. Echinoderms are now We are now officially in the red part of the plot. Echinoderms are around here, and we are also going to touch on Hemichordates if we have enough time. If not, then we will go on that in the next lecture. Echinoderms are also called the spiny skin animals, and they have pentaradial symmetry. I mentioned that before, the second number of the species alive and the second number of the species in the fossil record. Because they have an endoskeleton of calcium carbonate, they have a very good level of preservation in the fossil record, so they are well preserved. This is, I don't know if I show you this. I think I show you this, but I will go over that quickly. That there is the cross section of one of the arms in the sea star, and this is what we are going to use as a model. As a model to explain basically the metabolism and the different functions in this particular group. This is a marine phylum and had, as I mentioned before, an endoskeleton with calcium carbonate plates that you can see here in this cross section here. Those little blocks are all calcium carbonate plates. Endoskeleton because it's inside, like ours. We have an endoskeleton, it's not an exoskeleton like in the case of the crustaceans. Have it outside. So these ones do not have to deal with the issues associated with, for example, growth through molting that crustaceans or arthropoda have to deal with. Based on the fossil record and the larval development, we can see that both the larvae, are several larvae in this phylum, the larvae are all bilateral, and then the fossils of these organisms are all bilateral. That shows us that this phylum originally was bilateral. And as a secondary adaptation, they become radial or pentaradial because they have a symmetry of five.
Okay.
But originally, these are bilateral organisms. So when I talk in my dream about from now on, every single animal group that we're going to see is a bilateral. I was not lying. These become radial as a secondary adaptation. Okay. I think this is new material, so this is new for you. These basically show the development of something that is quite distinctive. This is one of the unique features in this particular group. This is what we call, excuse me, the water vascular system or ambulacral system. I think water vascular system is easier to remember. And it's basically what runs into the body of every single specimen of Echinoderms. This is again the formation of the xylem here. And that xylem there is going to become this central piece here that appears white or empty. That is basically the xylem in sea stars. This is an internal system that is basically formed from the xylem with the radial canals. Those radial canals go to each one of the arms of the sea star in this case, and basically produce also out pockets of the body wall that are known as podia. These in green, I suspect you can see green too. I hope you see green from the back. These are the podia, and basically these are kind of extensions of this vascular system. This system is used depending on which particular class we are talking about. There are several different classes, it's like six of them. They are used for locomotion, for feeding, for excretion, for gas exchange, etc., etc., etc. In some cases, become more specialized than in other cases, as we have seen before in our phyla. This is how locomotion works using those polyums, polya that you see here. Basically, what you have is the same principle that you would use or we reviewed when we were talking about the leeches in the annelids. That they use basically the two things that attach at the top and the bottom to move from one point to the other. They use exactly the same system, but they have many, many of these. If you take a sea star, I know we found just a few during the field trip to the Victoria Park. You turn it upside down, you will see very little legs coming out of the central areas on the sea star. Those are all the polyps, there will be hundreds of them. Okay? So, for locomotion, polya tend to be very important, but not for every class, just for some classes as you are going to see in a few minutes. you're going to see this also in action. I have a short video to show you that is, this is probably one of the most spectacular videos because it's short, it's very to the point, it's about echinoderms, and it really shows how nice they are as a group of study. Okay, this is other aspects of the vascular system in the echinoderms. This is kind of the skeleton of the system. You see here, there is a central ring. There is all the radial canals here to each one of the arms of the C-star, which is basically each one of these. And these are the polia, as you can see, look like a little funny things there all over the place, all along the each one of those arms. There is a point in the aural surface, basically at the top of the C-star, this little plate that you will see in dark and you will see in orange for one of the most common species of sea stars here in the island. It's called the mother chorite. Do I have the name there? Mother chorite on the aural core. The mother chorite basically is the one that acts as a filter for the water and basically controls to some extent the water pressure inside the body. This mother chorite is also unique to echinoderms. So if I ask you for a unique feature in this phylum, the mother chorite would be a right answer because no other phylum has a mother chorite. They may have things that kind of work similar, but not exactly the same. Okay, mother chorite is unique. The mother chorite is in the top. It's a circle that you will see in dark or in orange in the species that you have out there. And it's supposed to be in every single sea star that you're going to see around. In the other groups, you don't have a mother chorite or a mother chorite that's really, you know, very visible, but in sea stars, you do have that particular structure. Two other structures that are very important. Those are basically the radial canals here, basically that area there, and these are, again, each one of those are the polia that I was talking about just a minute ago. Okay. Excretion and respiration take us to two other structures that are quite important, papula and pedicellaria. In terms of excretion for solids, remember, sea stars tend to eat mussels or things like that, so they get a large amount of solids that they need to excrete afterwards. Most of those solids are expelled through the mouth. It's probably not the best way to do it, but it's the way they choose to do it, and apparently it works very well. Okay? They excrete through the mouth, especially the large thing. Everything else that is smaller, including gas exchange, is done through papulae. Or papula. It's with two L's here, with one L there. I think this is the right spelling for papula, which are dermal gills. I think I have a picture of that. There. Papula are projections of the coelom and help with the excretion, and this is explained here. Basically, this is the coelom or the water vascular system. And papulae are just these little projections that you see that basically come out of here and basically extrapolate here and close there and basically release into the water. Remember, echinoderms are marine species, so for the most part, they will be in the water all the time, not in terrestrial systems. Papulae therefore helps with basically accumulating all these dots that represent metabolic wastes or gases that the body doesn't need anymore. Papulae are these dermal gills that you see. They are located at the top of the sea star. This is an, you know, illustration of papulae there. Those little things that look like flowers or trees here, and these things that look like forks are called pedicellaria. Pedicellaria are claw-like structures that basically keep the surface clean. So papulae can actually do their work. If papulae are in charge of cleaning or keep clean the body from, you know, metabolic wastes, they have to be clean enough so they are able to send things away. If they are under a pack of debris, for example, they cannot work, and that's the purpose of these claw-like structures that you see there. So when you actually touch a sea star, many of these sandpaper sensation that you get when you're touching those is not just because of the small spines, it's also because of the pericellaria, which are these structures that are basically like this from the surface to avoid the accumulation of debris on top of them. Make sense? Makes sense. Okay, this is the classification of this is the classification of the Echinoderms, and we are going to put some emphasis on the first two because they are the most common ones, the one that you for sure have seen or more familiar with, and economically are also two of the most important ones. Ecologically also tend to play fairly important roles, and you're going to see that in the video in just 2 minutes. Asteroidea is the sea star or starfish. Echinoidea is the sea urchins. Holoturoidea are the sea cucumbers that in some regions of the world actually have quite a bit of a commercial importance, not so much in Atlantic Canada. Ophiuroidea are basically the brittle stars, which can be extremely, extremely abundant. And then Crinoidea are the less, probably the less diverse, the less well-known, and they look very much like flowers in the bottom of the sea. We're going to review the 5 classes, and we're going to focus primarily on the first two, and after the first two, I'm going to show you a short video that basically illustrates these organisms in action. Okay, let's talk about the first one. Asteroidea or sea stars. It's also called Stelleroidea in case that name is somehow easier for you. But in the final exam, if you say starfish or sea star, that's perfectly fine. Common names are perfectly fine as long as there is a common name. In this case, there is arms, as you know, around the central disk. There is 5 arms and can be more, and some of them can be actually smaller because they are in the process of regenerating. You probably have seen that, or I hope you read that somewhere. They have a thin epidermis over small ossicles, all of which is basically represented in this plot that again represents the cross section of an arm. When we say that these are small spines, means that they are just a protuberance, they're just coming out of the skin and they're not really big in comparison to, for example, the spines of the sea urchin, which are way longer, needle-like, and can really hurt you. the ossicles protrude over the body as spines, as you can see here, so these are all calcium carbonate spines, but they're not very prominent, just give you that sensation when you actually touch the sea stars. In terms of feeding, these are, was somebody still working in the previous one? In terms of feeding, they are a little bit peculiar because the oral, the mouth basically, is in the bottom, it's basically facing the ground, and the anus is actually facing up, basically when you see the dorsal part, if you want to call it that way. But the anus in sea star is not functional. It's functional in the other groups, but it's not functional in this one. Okay. The mouth does the same work that the anus usually does, which is basically the excretion of large particles, debris, and things like that that they're not going to use. They have a cardiac and a pyloric stomach, short intestine, and digestive glands. All of them, you can see here, basically extend into each one of the 5 arms of the sea star. And that should be pretty straightforward, I think. This is a little bit about the ecology without going too much into the ecology of these species. They tend to be carnivore species. They are more like an omnivore species because they can actually eat more than just meat. They can basically consume pretty much anything. just sprays that go to the stomach and the digestive glands that are located in each of the arms. Most of the food that is not digested, including debris, including pieces of shell, things that are basically not usable for them to eat, are ejected back through the mouth, as I mentioned before, because they are not using the anus for anything. They do have an anus, but they are not using it. Some of these species, some of these sea stars are keystone predators. You don't need to remember that word, I won't ask you about it. But keystone predators are very important players in marine communities, and not just in marine communities, in any kind of ecological community. A keystone predator is the one that keep in control, keep in check the dominant species in the system. So if in the system you have a keystone species, you have a lot of diversity. If you don't have that keystone species, you're going to have very low diversity because everything is going to be dominated by one dominant species. Okay? So they tend to play a very important role. At least some of the species of sea stars play very, very important roles. I'm sure you are going to see, are you taking ecology now? Some of you are taking ecology now, you probably are going to see, you haven't already seen the concept of keystone predator or keystone species. Or you are going to see it in the future in other courses. So if you take marine biology, you will see keystone species because they are quite, quite important. Okay. That's what they do. No. So weak, we are in pain, bones, etc. That's what they do. They basically keep in check, for example, mussels. Mussels is a dominant species in the coastal, in the rocky shoreline. You could see that in Victoria Park, you see that there were, in some areas, they were completely covered by mussels. Well, some species of sea stars are the ones that basically are able to control the growth of mussels, because they are the keystone predators. Again, I won't ask you in the final exam, what is a keystone predator or a keystone species, right? That's beyond this, which is just, I like very much that concept, that's all. Okay, the last thing that I want to say about sea stars is this, in terms of reproduction, the gonads, again, are located in each one of the arms. They are very reddish in color, even when there is a lot of variation. Plus, whenever you preserve the sea star, those colors tend to change anyway, so. These are the gonads there, and this is the cross section of the gonads in each side, basically, of the arm of the sea star. These would be part of the digestive system here, those large structures. They have a large capacity of regeneration, and that's what I say, you may find a number of sea stars out there with short arms that are just in the process of regenerating, basically coming back to a normal arm. It's not uncommon at all. Second. I think it's because most of the control in terms of nervous system is located in the central disc, so they can easily, you know, work towards regenerating the arm, that you're not losing part of your nervous system when you lose an arm. And all these things, the gonads and the digestive system can be basically grow up into the arm very, very easily. It's not like you are carrying the body up, and only half of your system are in one side and the other one are in the other. The arms will have all the system, but everything comes from the central power, so that's why they can just be lower. Very easy. They do. I think I have something about, let me see. They have a circulatory system that is not really different from the previous group, for models, for example. And I can give you more details about it. I didn't put anything in particular there because it's not quite unique. But I can give you more information about the circulatory system. Okay. The last thing that I want to mention, and this is important, I know you like LARPing. Probably not. You're going to learn to love LARPing. Let's put it that way. There's two sea star larvae. They're called Pipinaria and Brachiolaria. Don't worry, I want you to write those names so you have it, but I won't ask you those names in the final exam, I promise, okay? Pipinaria and Brachiolaria are the two larvae that you find in sea stars or starfish, okay? Okay, let's move on to the second group. It's a little bit different. There is no arms, there is a lot of spines. And in this case, absolutely everything is inside that central round structure that you call the body. The visceral organs, meaning the reproductive organs and the digestive system, are all located inside this test, this thing that you see here, basically the round form of the C arch. Everything is inside this round structure. Nothing comes out as arms of any kind. The ossicles that you saw in the sea stars are now fairly large and are actually fused together. So this one are much more rigid than the sea star. The sea star have certain flexibility when you move the arms, for example. Sea urchins tend to be much more hard and basically rigid. You cannot really move around things because they are all fused together. And the spines that you see here, which is probably what everyone will recognize because it's the most distinctive feature for sea urchins, are all movable, and in fact, in some cases, especially for some species, those are used also in the process of locomotion. Those are not just for defense, they're also in the used in the process of locomotion. Okay, there is no arms, but there is still five ambulacral regions. Ambulacral means water vascular system regions. And you can see those here. These basically are what you would call arms in the sea star. Each one of those lines and each one of those little dots that you see is basically where the podia come out outside. Okay? So essentially, when you look carefully, this is a sea star that just basically put all these arms together and basically fuse everything together like a little package. Okay? The anatomy is very, very similar. You can easily see that sea urchins are pentaryon organisms, very similar to the sea stars. Sea urchins live on hard substrates and scrape algae. Most of them do that. That's usually the most common type of ecological role. And they have this structure here in the center that look like a conical thing that basically goes down into the ground. It's called the Aristotle's lantern, and it's a mastication or a scraping organ. This is equivalent to the radula in snails and octopus and other molluscs. Ecologically equivalent. They are completely different origins, but this is basically what the radula does in molluscs. Locomotion is still based on 2 feet that come out of those little holes here in the bottom part of the organism. But again, the spines in some species are able to also help a little bit on the locomotion. Aristotle lantern is very unique, and it will be also something unique for sea urchins and for echinoderms in general, because there is no Aristotle lanterns anywhere else in the animal kingdom. Okay, nowhere else. Just make sure that you know that this is present in sea urchins, but it's not in sea stars or in the other groups of echinoderms. Yep. Exactly. Yeah. The radula in mollusks, and this, the Aristotle lantern here, will be a good example of convergent evolution. I was thinking convergent evolution as opposed to divergent evolution. Two structures become to do exactly the same function, but they have origins that are completely unrelated. Okay, they are not related at all. They just do the same. This is some sort of general classification. We don't want to go into classes, orders, suborders, because we will spend an entire course on this. We're going to distinguish 2 types of sea urchins: the regular, which is the typical sea urchin that you find here and elsewhere, the ones with the spines, the ones that you are used to. And then you have irregular sea urchins, which include the sand dollar, like this, which can be found in the island and can be found in Atlantic Canada. And also the hard urchin, which is basically a sea urchin that's not really symmetrical. You are going to see both in the video that I'm going to show you at the end of this slide. at the end of the next slide, actually. Sand dollars are a very distinctive type of sea urchin. They belong into the same group, but are obviously very different because the spines, the prominent spines, are just not there. And they tend to live in soft sediments, either tidal flats or sandy sediments in the subtidal, basically in the water. They are depositing feeders, unlike sea urchins, which tend to be herbivores. Remember, they scrape algae, they eat seaweeds, they like to eat seaweeds. Most sea urchins are herbivores, because it's vegetarian species. The sea urchin larva is called Echinoderms. Echinoderms. Can't believe you don't like larvae. Just joking. Has anybody here ever ate sea urchins? No one? You're missing a lot. They're really, really good. They're delicious. I'm going to show you a slide now that shows a little bit of that. I think it's mainly a cultural thing. But you should try sometime. Okay. This is the ecological role play for some of these sea urchins. In rocky shores and kelp forests, they create something called the urchin barrens, and you're going to see that in just a minute. Okay? You're going to see those in high velocity, high speed camera showing basically what they do and how they basically do a lot of things. And there's other species that live, for example, this one, Dialema. It's a type of sea urchin. As you can see here, it's a black sea urchin that is very, very important in tropical areas, in coral reef areas, because they control the seaweeds that compete with the coral reefs. So it's a good Dialema there. If you, for any reason, you lose Dialema, which has happened because of disease, for example, seaweeds start to grow out of control, and then you lose a lot of coral reefs, which you don't want to lose, because coral reefs means diversity. That is the other important thing, Santa Alicia, and this could be somewhere promoting basically sea urchins as something that you can eat. These little five little things that you see here are the gonads. They are more orange than yellow, and they are delicious. Even though you won't believe me, you should try some time. They are really, really good. Okay? In South America, this is really something delicious that you can go and to a restaurant and ask for it because it's really, really good. So, try, okay? Don't just look at them and say, okay, let me show you a quick video. Let's see how this works.
Carry a constant supply of nutrients up from the depths to the surface layer. These upwellings fertilize forests of giant kelp that thrive in the summer sunshine. The algal towers are as high as a three-story house, and they can grow by half a meter a day. In any other forest, but the cost is less familiar. An army of sea urchins is mounting an attack. The urchin plague strikes at the kelp's holdfasts, their crucial attachments to the rock. Extremely tough, but each urchin has 5 teeth, which are self-sharpening and are replaced every few months.
The teeth are associated with
urchins fell vast areas of kelp forest, creating clearings known as urchin barrens. Yet, barrens is a poor description. Millions of invertebrates invade the seabed. The most fearsome predator here is a giant. The sunflower starfish is a meter across, with an appetite for brittle stars. Uses its feet to taste for prey. When its actions are speeded up, it becomes clear that the predator's fondness for the brittle stars is almost matched by the brittle star's ability to get out of the way. Doesn't seem to work against the sunflower starfish. The predator extrudes its stomach and wraps it around its victims, liquefying their soft parts. Nothing is left except their white skeletons.
Starfish, the little starfish, and you already saw the brittle stars. That's the name. I was just looking for brittle stars. We're going to talk about brittle stars in the next slide. This is the third class of echinoderms. It's called holothuroidea, or more simple, sea cucumbers. Sea cucumbers have some importance, especially in Asian markets, where it's used in the commercial history, so they said there's actually a fishery or a harvesting industry for them. It's not so important here, and but I mean it does have some economic relevance when it comes to business, but it's not that great. In this case, there is no arms, or I should say no external arms. The oral axis has been basically enlarged, so this organism becomes like these. The top and the bottom becomes basically run away from each other and become this long thing that looks like some sort of large worm. And the tentacles now develop around the mouth. People love sea cucumbers, as you can see there. The ossicles, the calcium carbonate ossicles that basically give the strength to the sea urchins and basically give those little spines to the sea. The sea stars become very, very much reduced, almost lost, and that's why these are so basically soft. They're very, very tender. They're not rigid as a sea star. The way you will feel a sea star whenever you touch a sea star looks very, very stiff. These ones are very soft. The dermis is still thick, but it's very, very flexible. Indeed, in some Asian markets, they don't actually eat the sea cucumber. They actually open the sea cucumber, remove the organs, and use the sea cucumber as basically the rub for putting food inside, basically. Okay? Just to show you how tender they can be. The larva, because there is always a larva, in this species is called auricularia. And I promise I won't ask you about auricularia. Okay? But write it down because you need to have it in your notes. The umbilical lines, or the umbilical groves, which are basically the lines of the podia of the vascular system, are also visible here, and you can probably see them there. Instead of having them in the bottom, as sea starts to do, they just have them basically in fine lines around the body. This is the fourth class, it's called Ophiuroidea, or Ophiuroidea. Ophiuroidea is fine, and it's, you better go by brittle stars because that should be way easier. Brittle stars are the most diverse and abundant class, curiously. See some of the abundance in the video that I just showed you, where you have like a layer of brittle stars over the bottom, basically running away from the large sea stars. They have a slender arms around a central disc, and in this case, the visceral organs are all inside that central disc. And like the sea star, where you have the visceral organs going into each one of the arms, here everything stays inside this structure here. That's why these are so slender and can be so flexible. Okay? You don't have these internal organs in each of the arms. Other than that, they look very much like a sea star, so they're just more slender, more flexible. There is an orenocus madreporae here. This is the mouth here in the bottom where they're basically eating. There is a no prominent intestine or anus, yes, and stomach. They have four plates surrounding the mouth that you can see there. Jaws, and they have two feet reduced because they are used only for feeding, just to attach the prey or being stuck to the prey, and they use the arms for locomotion. They don't use the 2 feet for locomotion, as in the case of the sea urchins and in the case of the sea stars. Yes, there is a larva. Of course there is a larva. There. Oh. This should be a P here. This should be Ophiuroidea. Let me fix it for you. I know you want the right information, so. There you go. That's the name of the larva of Ophiuroidea, or the brittle stars. That again, I want you to write down, but I don't ask you about it. I won't ask you for the name of the larva. Getting the feeling that you're not like another week, so. Okay. Can I move to the next one? Okay, last class of the day is the Echinoderms, or the feathered stars, or the sea lilies. Any of those names will work. If I ask you in the final exam about Echinoderms and actually say Echinoderms, I will put in between brackets sea lilies or feathered stars, so you know what I'm talking about. Just in case you don't remember that name. They have a leather kind skin with plates again, and five main branches with pinnules. Pinnules are basically those flexible arms that you see there in the picture over here. The mouth faces upward. These are filter feeders. Most echinoderms are either grazers, or some of them are suspension feeders, but for the most part they are either carnivores or as herbivores. These ones are suspension feeders or filter feeders. The food is trapped with the help of mucus, with help of in mucus, without the in. And obviously, as you can see there, these arms, these are the ones that are going to basically attract or create a current, and that they are going to basically be trapping whatever is visible in the water column from them. That's what you're looking for. The larva of this particular class is called Dolio Laria. I have to show you just one more slide with the picture, just so you are aware where they are and where we are in relation to them. As soon as I see that you guys know why I'm going to show you. Good. This is based on the classification that we just went through. These are the 5 different groups: sea stars, Ophiuroidea, Echinoderma, Hemichordates, and Crinoidea. And you can see that there is one group that come out here that's quite related. It's called Hemichordata. Hemichordata. Chordata relates to chordates. Chordates relates to vertebrates, and vertebrates relate to us. There is where the connection is with us. We're going to start the next lecture basically talking about this particular finding, which is the link between these ones and the chordates. Okay? That will be the next lecture.
D1.
D1?
Yeah.